students, ito yung pinaka-start ng ating electronic systems and technologies. We will be discussing introduction to electronics communication today. So I am Engineer Randy Aliado from MORF Cebu. Okay, let's talk about the subtopics na di-discuss natin sa subject na to. So we have electronics communication systems, then we will be discussing the electromagnetic spectrum, then we'll go with the decibels, gain losses, then the noise and noise analysis. Okay, let's begin with the electronics communication. So ano ba yung electronics communication? Now, electronic communication is obviously the communication using electronics electronic circuits. This is the transmission. So when you communicate, there must be a source, transmission, then there must be a receiver, no? Reception, and the processing of information, no? So kailangan ma-transmit natin yung information from the source side to the destination side, flowing into your channel, kumbaga, no? So kaya nga there are three basic sections ng isang electronics communication system. So one is the transmitter, obviously the source, then we also have the receiver, which is the destination, and lastly we have the communication channel that serves as the medium. So we have here the illustration of a communication system. So we have the transmitter, we have the receiver, and the link is the communication channel, in which sa tatlong to, between the or among the transmitter, receiver, and the channel, yung pinaka vulnerable sa noise dito, or kumbaga pinaka madaling maapektuhan ng noise, is actually the communication channel. So kaya nga, if you will compare kung sino yung mas magandang channel in terms of noise immunity, transmission line ba or di kaya your free space, then obviously the free space will be more immune to noise than the transmission line, rather, is more immune to noise kumpara sa free space. So mas noisy yung free space kasi nga walang regulation doon, no? So kumpara sa transmission line na dinesign yun, na yung noise is hindi makapasok or makakancel lang. So kaya nga isang buong topic natin next time will be to talk about transmission lines lang talaga, no? So for now, para alam natin kung paano mabawasan or ma-eliminate yung effects ng noise, then we need to discuss also the parameters of noise today. So alamin natin yung ating kalaban para matatalo natin. So parang ganun yung idea dito. So we cannot completely eliminate the noise. We can only lessen, no, the effects of this noise into our communication system. Okay, so ito na yung mga primary sections natin. We have the transmitter that converts your information into a form more suitable for transmission over a given channel. So, kumbaga, yung pinaka-common natin ng mga mensahe or information is voice, video. So, there must be a way to convert this into a form or a signal na suitable na siya for transmission. So, like, ipapasakay ba natin siya sa carrier para makapag-travel siya in a longer destination into a specific frequency. So, that is job ni transmitter. So channel is obviously the link. So doon dadaan yung ating information, doon dadaan yung ating modulating signal, no? So sa channel na to, no? Or the modulated signal if kailangan ng modulation. So that would be the communication channel. Kumbaga is the link. And lastly, the one that converts the modulated signal back into information, into an audible information, is the receiver. Accepts the transmitted message from the channel and converts it back into a form understandable na by humans. So, kumbaga, input ng transmitter is information, output ng receiver is the same exact information. So, yun dapat yun. Okay, so now let's continue with the signal na pag-uusapan natin all throughout our discussion sa buong subject ng ISAT. So, the sine wave, no? the information na ito. So, it could be information, it could be carrier, but this is the main equation ng isang sine wave, and we have talked about this during the electronics na discussions natin. Now, in a sine wave, we know that this is the phase, this is the frequency, this is the maximum voltage, this is the instantaneous voltage. Now, in the sine wave, we can actually vary three parameters here, in which yun yung magbibigay ng daan para makapag-create tayo ng tinatawag na modulation. No? So there are three properties of a sine wave that could be changed, and that namely is the amplitude. This will result into AM if we will change it. The frequency will result to FM if we will change the frequency, and the phase known as PM if we will change the phase naman. No? So ito yung tatlong pwede nating baguhin sa properties ng isang sine wave. So ngayon, hindi pa natin i-discuss yung modulation because that would be our next topic na. No? So for now, we'll only talk about the introduction lang talaga, no? Mga basic parameters ng electronic systems and technologies. Okay, let's talk about the types of information signal. So we have two general classifications of information signal. We have the analog and we have the digital. Now, the analog is basically yung pinaka-common na mga information o mga messages. No? So that is in terms of voice and video, yung pinaka-common talaga na nire-relay natin or pinapadala. No? So, and all of these are represented by a sine wave. So basta sine wave yung nagre-represent, ibig sabihin analog yung signal na yun. So continuous, no? yun yung keyword dyan. No? These are signals characterized by a waveform that is continuously varying voltage and current such as a sine wave. So basta sine wave, ibig sabihin analog yan. Now, pag sinasabi mong digital, discrete ito continuous, no? Tapos pag digital naman, it is discrete. So discrete means paisa-isa, no? And in digital form, we normally use binary for our information here, no? It varies only within two specific boundaries or two specific limits, like the high and the low, the logic 1 and the logic 0. So yun yung tinatawag nating binary. And of course, if the voltage will only vary between two possible states, then that would be represented or can be represented by a square wave or a rectangular wave. So kaya nga ganito yung digital natin na signal. Okay, so alam na natin yung dalawa, no? Analog and digital, and pinaka-common na information talaga, like raw, hilaw na information, that would be the analog. But we can always convert the analog to digital. We can also convert digital to analog. Now, can we transmit analog over a transmission line? Yes, we can transmit analog over a transmission line. Can we transmit digital over a transmission line? Yes, we can transmit digital directly over a transmission line. Can we transmit analog directly into free space? Yes, we can. No? Can we transmit digital directly into free space? No, we cannot. No? So if you want to transmit your digital information into free space, then you need to modulate it. You need to convert it into analog before it could be transmitted. So yun yung limitation ng digital. Whereas the analog can be directly transmitted over the space, over the free space. Okay, let's differentiate now, or let's talk about the generation of frequencies. How do we generate frequencies? Kasi ngayon pinag-usapan natin parati sa isa't is frequency of this, frequency of that, no? Frequency of the carrier, frequency of the information. But how do we really generate these frequencies? Yun yung pag-uusapan natin. So pinaka-common circuit to generate what we want na frequency, for example, for our carrier, no? Para magkaroon tayo ng carrier, is yung tinatawag nating oscillator. But we already discussed oscillators during electronics na topic natin, so we'll no longer talk about this oscillator na in details talaga. No? So we know that oscillators provide us with sine waves or oscillation, and there are different types of oscillators that are basically available. No? We have LC, we have RC, we have crystal oscillators. Now, in electronic systems and technologies, these oscillators are used in different applications. No? So pinaka-common talaga na pinaggagamitan ng oscillators in ESAT is to provide us with carrier. So paano natin maipapasakay yung ating information into a higher frequency if we don't have any means to generate these high frequency signals? So to generate these high frequency signals which will carry your information into your destination, we need to create these signals. And that could be provided to us by the oscillators. It could be LC oscillators or it could be RC oscillators. Pilot supplies and clock circuits, that could also be an application for your oscillators. So as we go on with our discussion sa mga higher na subjects natin or topics natin sa ESAT, mas ma-appreciate natin yung gamit ng mga oscillators na ito. Now, to sustain oscillation, we have already discussed this during electronics. Now, we need to maintain two criteria, no? And this is provided to us by what we term as the Barkhausen criteria. So in the Barkhausen criteria, as we know, the AB, the loop gain must be equal to 1, and the feedback must be positive, di ba? So yun yung general Barkhausen's criteria. No? So the loop gain, the net gain around the feedback loop must be unity, or initially it should be greater, but once ma-achieve mo na yung amplitude stabilization mo, you need to decrease your gain into A times B equal to 1. So amplifier gain and feedback loop equal to 1. And for the feedback, it needs to be integer multiple of 360, or that is what we call positive feedback. So in short, if I have an amplifier and gawin kong oscillator, so dapat pagbalik ng signal na kukunin ko sa output, dapat in phase siya, no? This is sustained oscillation, and that is under the Barkhausen criteria. So hindi pa rin natatapos yung electronics natin sa electronics, no? We are still applying the concept of electronics in our subject na electronic systems and technologies. Okay, so alam na natin yung mga criteria na yan. So let's talk about some of the examples ng oscillators natin. So this is just basically refresh lang, no, sa ating mga natutunan sa electronics. Now, SA oscillators are normally used for lower spectrum lang na oscillation, no? So hindi sila magandang gagamitin dun sa mga higher megahertz or gigahertz. So for LC oscillators, we have the examples, no? The Hartley-Colpitz and Clapp. So hindi na nasali dito yung pinaka-unstable sa kanilang lahat, which is the Armstrong. Now for Hartley, we know that the feedback element doon is a top inductor, and this is the parallel LC oscillator. The Colpitz has a top capacitor feedback element with a parallel LC pa rin. And the Clapp has a feedback element na top capacitor, but this time around it uses series LC. So yun yung difference ng tatlong to, no? Parallel LC using top inductor, parallel LC using top capacitor, series LC using top capacitor. So we have discussed that already during the electronics. But the problem ng mga LC oscillators is that they cannot provide us with that stability that we need pagdating sa generation ng carrier. So kaya nga, para sa stability, kailangan crystal talaga. Okay, so let's talk about an example of an LC oscillator, a varactor-tuned oscillator. So this is using a varactor. No? We know a varactor is a diode, so a diode, a varactor diode. So varactor-tuned oscillator, the frequency of the oscillator can be generally be varied by either varying the capacitance and the inductance, but it is simpler to vary the capacitance than to vary the inductance of an inductor or capacitance ng isang component. So because mabilis baguhin yung capacitance kumpara sa inductance, we normally use variable capacitors such as variable capacitor diodes or the varactors. So varactors are more convenient substitute than variable capacitors for the reason na varactors can be electrically changed, no? Yung capacitors nila can be electrically changed kumpara sa variable capacitors na manual mong ibabago or babaguhin, no? So how do varactor diodes change their capacitance? It's actually pretty simple. The idea is napaka-simple. No? We have the PN junction diode. Tapos we know that the PN junction diode has a depletion region like here. No? So if you will increase the reverse bias, because varactors must be reverse bias, this is negative and this is positive. If I will increase this reverse bias, the depletion region will widen. And this is a negative charge. And this is positive charge. Depletion region is an insulator. So there is an insulator in between the positive and negative that simply creates a simple capacitor. In which, if I will increase the reverse bias, the distance between the plates, kumbaga, sa inyong capacitor is nag-widen, decreasing its capacitance. But if I will decrease the reverse bias voltage across my varactor, then the depletion region narrows. As the depletion region narrows, the distance between the plates, kumbaga in your capacitor, is nag-decrease, creating a much greater capacitance, because we know that capacitance is equal to this formula. Smaller distance increases the capacitance, and greater distance between the plates decreases the capacitance. So by changing the magnitude of your reverse bias voltage across the varactor, it also changes the distance of this depletion region. And with that, it could increase or decrease the capacitance. So by increasing and decreasing the capacitance electrically using this tuning voltage na tinatawag natin, if this will be connected in tandem with an inductor, then we can simply vary its resonant frequency, which is equal to 1 over 2 pi square root of LC. So by varying the C, we can also vary the resonant frequency, then that could be a tuned oscillator na. We can decide kung ano yung gusto nating magiging output frequency. So this is an example of a varactor controlled resonant circuit na LC. So as you can see, if the voltage here increases, it increases the reverse bias of this varactor diode, decreasing its capacitance. No, when the capacitance decreases, when the depletion region rather, no? So as I increase this reverse bias voltage, the depletion region there will widen. So as the depletion region widens, it decreases the capacitance. So if it decreases the capacitance, then it increases the resonant frequency of this tank. Whereas if the signal here deviates into the negative, so dito positive, if it becomes more negative, then the reverse bias dito is nagdi-decrease, no? So nagdi-decrease yung reverse bias mo. And at the same time, decreasing the reverse bias narrows the depletion region. Narrowing the depletion region increases your capacitance. That in turn decreases your resonant frequency. So kitang-kita natin dito na habang nagbabago yung capacitance ni varactor, nagbabago yung output frequency natin dito. So with that, we can use it as an oscillator, a tuned oscillator. That nakadepende yung kanyang output sa voltahe na pinapasok mo dito. No? So that's what you call control voltage. So you can have a fixed control voltage or you can vary the control voltage if you want to vary also the output frequency of this tuned oscillator. So to get the new capacitance of a varactor, we can also follow this formula. No? So this is the initial capacitance of the varactor. And as you increase the tuning voltage, there will be a decrease, no, in the capacitance. And we have discussed that already. No? An increase in the voltage reverse bias here decreases the capacitance because it will widen the depletion region. But decreasing the tuning voltage increases the capacitance because decreasing the tuning voltage will lessen the reverse bias. And with that, it narrows the depletion region, increasing your capacitance. So that is really proved also by this equation here. So we can simply create an oscillator na pwedeng ma-tune or pwedeng mabago yung kanyang resonant frequency by just using a varactor in tandem with an inductor. So that's an example of an LC oscillator, but the limitation pa rin dyan is hindi siya ganun ka-stable pa rin. So if we really want stable oscillators, then we need to use crystal oscillators. So crystal oscillators have their advantage in which napaka-stable nila. No? So kumbaga yung kanyang deviation or yung kanyang pagbabago ng frequency is napaka-late lang. And lahat ng pagbabago na to ng kanyang frequency is nakadepende sa tinatawag nating temperature. No? So kaya nga, if you really want to maintain the output frequency of a crystal oscillator, then might as well put it in an oven para makontrol yung temperatura ng isang crystal. So yun, ginagawa yun practically. No? So the oscillator with the most adequate frequency stability. So wala nang tatalo sa stability ni crystal. So frequency stability obviously is yung pag-stay mo sa isang frequency, hindi ka nababago. So crystal oscillators are known to be very stable talaga. But sometimes meron disadvantage yung pagiging stable din ng crystal. Halimbawa, walang problema if you will use this crystal oscillator in a type of modulation where the frequency must be kept constant, such as an AM. But what if gagamitin mo siya sa FM, that the frequency of the carrier must be kept changing depending sa magnitude ng inyong modulating signal. So that becomes a limitation of crystal oscillators now na application. So hindi siya magandang gamitin sa tinatawag na FM. But in our discussion soon ng angle modulation, you will find out also na even in generation of commercial FM, crystals are still used. And kung paano yun ginagamit, and paano yun namamanipulate ng mga engineers to design a frequency modulated output by using a very stable oscillator na parang hindi nagbabago, is if we find out natin sa topics na yun. So we look forward to that. Paano kaya nila ginawa yun? Parang impossible. But hindi impossible. Meron talagang paraan. Okay, so let's talk about how this frequency of the oscillator change with respect to the temperature. So ito yung formula actually natin. So yung pagbabago ng crystal frequency is nakadepende sa coefficient of coupling and yung change in temperature mo. So the temperature of the temperature coefficient rather, not temperature coefficient, coupling coefficient, but temperature coefficient. So the temperature coefficient is in the rating hertz per megahertz per degree Celsius, or if you say hertz per megahertz, that is the same as 1 over 1 times 10 to the 6, and that is 1 part per million. So yun na yung tinatawag na part per million. They are basically the same as hertz per megahertz. Part per million is the same as hertz per megahertz. Yun, yung dalawa na pareho lang yan. So per degree Celsius, per degree Celsius. So this temperature affects your change in frequency. The greater the change in temperature, the greater will be the change in frequency. And crystals also exhibit positive temperature coefficient or negative temperature coefficient. So positive temperature coefficient means the frequency change is lumalaki. Pag lumalaki yung inyong temperatura, oh, or negative temperature is humababa yung total frequency mo na output pag bumababa yung temperatura, no? So that is positive or negative. So bakit pag positive lumalaki yung output frequency, bakit pag negative lumiliit yung output frequency? It depends, it is based actually on this idea, no? That the output frequency is equal to the natural crystal frequency plus the change in frequency, no? So pag negative temperature coefficient ka, ma-minus to, no? Pag positive temperature coefficient ka, ma-plus yan. So kaya nga the output depends on whether you have a plus temperature coefficient or minus na temperature coefficient. Now, you can use this formula to get the change, but you can also use this formula to get the output frequency. So I would recommend these formulas in the box, no, na gagamitin natin para mahanap yung hinahanap sa board exam. So ito, para change lang to, no? So if you don't like this formula, gusto mo by concept talaga, pwede ito na lang yung i-memorize mo. Then pagkatapos na yun, if gusto niyang kunin yung output frequency, you simply need to add or subtract it from your natural crystal frequency. Yun pa rin yung output frequency mo, no? So kumbaga, itong formula na to is ano na lang, no? Dinerive na lang galing sa Fn plus delta F. So because if you substitute this delta F with this term right here, you can factor out the Fm, leaving us with 1 plus k delta t. But these two are actually the same. Itong dalawang to is pareho lang. So kaya nga, it's either ito lang yung i-memorize mo, then i-plus mo na lang ito sa Fn mo pag hinahanap yung output frequency, or you can also memorize this other formula. It's really up to you. Okay, so now let's move on to frequency multipliers. So kanina nag-generate tayo. Ngayon, we'll try to increase the output frequency by using frequency multipliers. Now, frequency multipliers can only multiply their harmonics, or kumbaga, they can only multiply by a factor of their integer multiple. So that's the limitation of frequency multipliers. If you have 1 MHz, you can only produce 2 MHz or 3 MHz. You can never produce 1.5. So frequency multipliers are harmonic generators. Harmonics lang yung kaya nila. So we know that harmonics are integer multiple of their fundamental frequency. Like 1 times FA is the first harmonic. 2 times the FA. FA is the fundamental frequency, is equal to the second harmonic, and 3FA is equal to or the same as the third harmonic. So that's what you call harmonic. So ito lang yung mga factors natin na ma-multiply sa ating input frequency and becomes the output of our frequency multipliers. Now, frequency multipliers can be efficient only up to a factor of 3, no? Hanggang 3 lang, or 3 lang na multiplication factor. Ayan, multiplication factor of 3. Above 3, it would be inefficient na and impractical. So if there is a need to increase your frequency beyond the factor of 3, there is no worry actually, because we can cascade naman multipliers para by doing that, mas ma-increase pa natin yung multiplication factor. Like dalawang 3 and 3, that would be multiplied by 9 na. No? So kaya nga, hindi ganun kahirap if you want a higher multiplication factor, because pwede ka naman gumamit ng mga naka-series or naka-cascade na mga frequency multipliers. But a single frequency multiplier having a multiplication factor of 10, hindi na practical yan. No? So it's inefficient. So might as well use maliliit na frequency multipliers sa tag 3, 10 i-series na lang para ma-achieve mo yung gusto mo na multiplication ng frequency mo. So for frequency multipliers to be generating these harmonics na audible pa, no? Because we know that in your signals na analysis, every increase ng inyong harmonics will decrease its magnitude. So in order for you to have an audible output pa rin na harmonic, even if nandun na sa 2 or 3, then kailangan na yung amplifier na gagamitin for your frequency multipliers must be configured as classy, no? So it needs to be classy, because what we need here is higher output power, no? We need efficiency, no? And that is provided by the classy amplifier. So kaya nga frequency multipliers are actually classy amplifiers, classy amplifiers sila. Okay, so let's talk about mixing. So we are still dealing with generating frequencies dito. Now, mixing is combining. So the mixing is the process of combining two or more signals, and is essential process in electronics communication for the reason na in transmission, in reception, we always use mixing. So ano ba yung mix, ano ba yung dalawang uri ng mixing? So we have linear and non-linear mixing. And alin kaya dito yung mas dominante na ginagamit sa electronics communication? Let's begin with linear mixing. Pag sinabi mo linear mixing, you feed two or more frequencies into a linear device and it outputs actually only the frequencies din na pinasok mo. So linear mixing is when two or more signals combine in a linear lang na device such as resistor or inductor or a small signal amplifier, in which yung limitation ng linear mixing is that it won't really produce so much different frequencies at the output. Kung ano yung pinasok mo na frequency sa input, yun din yung lalabas, no? Parang ano lang talaga, linear summing lang talaga siya, no? So also referred as linear summing. So that's the reason why in communications work, sa ating mga discussion so far, soon, at saka sa mga babasahin nyo ng libro, when the author says mixing, it doesn't really talk about linear mixing. No? So kung sinabi mixing lang, no, hindi specified kung anong uring mixing, that author really tells you na non-linear yung process, no, no? Not the linear one. Why? Because yun nga, mas common yung non-linear sa comms kasi nga mas nakakapag-produce siya ng gusto natin na frequency at the output. So non-linear mixing is when two or more signals are combined in a non-linear device such as diodes, such as transistors. So yun yung mga non-linear devices. And the good thing about non-linear mixing is that it produces what we term as the cross-product. So cross-product frequencies. Ano ba yung cross-product frequencies? So the cross-product frequencies are actually the sum and difference frequencies. If meron kayong dalawang signals na ipapasok sa isang non-linear mixer, yung lalabas nun is hindi lang yung dalawang frequencies na yun, but it also produces the sum and the difference. And hindi lang yun, it can also produce the harmonics and the sum and differences. So yun yung napakaganda ng non-linear mixing, because if ano yung gusto natin na frequency dun sa output, magkakaroon tayo ng chance na piliin kung ano yung gusto natin. No? Do we want the sum only? Do we want the difference only? So that would be in sa daming lumalabas na posibleng output sa non-linear mixing, by the use of a filter, we can now choose which of those frequencies is gagamitin natin sa ating system. No? And we cannot do that sa linear because we are only limited with output frequencies. No? So sa non-linear, we can produce cross-product. And again, cross-product are the sum and differences of the two original signals or frequencies and also the sum and differences of their harmonics. So that is mas preferred, no? Sa communications talaga na application. But kung isipin natin, if nonlinear mixing produces sum and differences and not only between the two original signals but also with the sum and differences of their harmonics, then we could say na theoretically speaking, there would be an infinite number of harmonics and cross product frequencies, no? In a nonlinear device. But practically speaking, alam naman natin na habang lumalaki yung frequency, lumiliit talaga yung magnitude. So there will be times na hindi na talaga natin kayang magamit yan o hindi na pwedeng gamitin yan. Kaya nga sa ating frequency multiplier, we are allowed only to use up to 2 or 3 multiplication factor, because beyond that, it would be impractical and inefficient na. So, but theoretically speaking, this will go on up to infinity talaga yung pag-produce na harmonics mo at saka cross-product mo. So that would be for the non-linear mixing. Okay, so let's talk about the output na frequencies ng isang linear non-linear mixer. So this is an illustration of a linear mixing or linear mixer. So as you can see, pinasok yung A and B, lumabas lang yung dalawang frequency ng A and B. So wala nang sum and differences. Whereas if this is a non-linear mixer, pag pinasok mo VA and VB with certain frequencies, hindi lang itong mga frequencies na ito yung lalabas, pati na yung kanilang mga harmonics and the sum and the differences. So that's characteristic talaga of non-linear mixing. So kaya nga in modulation, we always use non-linear because nga we need to produce the sum and difference, halimbawa for AM. So non-linear mixing is ito talaga yung pinaka-common sa ating mga communication processes. So again, if sasabihin ng author pag nagbabasa ka na mixing, so that refers to the non-linear, hindi sa linear na uri. Okay, let's differentiate naman the terminologies na ito, no? Baseband versus the broadband. Ano ba yung kaibahan ng dalawa? Now to differentiate the baseband transmission and the broadband transmission, we need to know first, ano ba talaga yung ibig sabihin ng baseband or the baseband signal? So baseband transmission is a transmission, but how? No? So actually, we need to define first what is a baseband signal. No? So a baseband signal is the raw signal. Kumbaga, it's the original information. Kumbaga, it's the pure information, like the pure voice or the pure video na gusto mong isi-send. In short, hindi pa siya na-process into modulation. So hindi pa siya ginamit to change something in a career. No? It's like a recording, no? The raw recording na hindi mo pa pinasakay sa career. That's what you call baseband. So it could also be the pure digital information, no? That still is baseband pa rin. No? So as long as it is the original information or intelligence, whether it is digital or analog, that will always be considered as baseband. So examples ng baseband are obviously voice, video. No? So kaya nga, if this voice or video or digital signals are directly transmitted over the transmission line, then we call it baseband transmission. So yun yung tinatawag nating baseband transmission. If the baseband signal is directly transmitted over the medium, that's baseband transmission. So example are household intercom or Ethernet. So pinaka-characteristic ng baseband is magagawa mo lang siya in a wired system. So basta wide lang. No? Kasi nga pag wireless na, kailangan mo na ng modulation dun. So hindi na yung baseband transmission kasi nga yung baseband mo na signal sumakay na sa isang high frequency carrier. So iba na yan. So for baseband, it's pure transmission of raw information or original information such as in the Ethernet. No? So like halimbawa, in a standard na 10 base 2, no? Ethernet standard yan, no? 10 megabits per second baseband. So ibig sabihin baseband transmission to with a distance of approximately 200 meters. So that's an example of digital na baseband. So it could either be baseband na analog or baseband na digital. The only limitation lang talaga ng baseband is that yung compatibility nito sa ating pinaka-available na channel known as the free space, no? So if you really want to transmit over long distance, wala nang ibang available channel pa na libre lang gamitin at saka hindi magastos, no? Yung free space na tinatawag or the atmosphere. So baseband transmission is incompatible with that. So hindi siya compatible with the free space medium. So kaya nga for long distance transmission talaga, then we need, wala tayong choice kundi gumamit ng broadband, no? Like mga intercontinental, inter-island. So mas better na gamitin yung broadband transmission. So baseband signal is the raw signal. So when you transmit this raw signal or original information directly over the medium, then that is what we call baseband transmission. Pero pag yung baseband signal mo is na-transmit mo but prior to transmission, pinasakay mo na sa isang carrier, then that would be the broadband. So yun yung broadband transmission. So a type of transmission where the baseband signal is used to modulate a higher frequency carrier upon transmission. So yun na yun. Basta may carrier na, yung baseband signal mo pinasakay na, so that becomes broadband na. No? So examples ito are obviously the broadcasting. No? AM broadcast, FM broadcast, FM yung cellular na ginagamit natin. No? So that's long distance wireless na. No? So that is broadband. PSK, it is digital. No? This is digital. Phase shift keying, no? So we will discuss this together with the FSK and the QAM, no? So and in our discussion there, we will really prove it that these types of transmission is basically broadband, because when you say PSK, FSK, ASK or QAM, there is a carrier na, no? Pinapasakay na yung digital information into the carrier, so that would be definitely broadband. So satellite comms, broadband, it's as long as it is wireless, no? It is always broadband. Okay, so but is there any broadband also na gumagamit ng wire? Meron din, ah. So as long as pinapasakay yung isang information sa carrier, then we can definitely say it's broadband. Now, the advantage of broadband is that it's possible na sa isang wire, halimbawa sa isang coaxial cable, you will let this information ride into a lower frequency carrier, then another information ride into a mid frequency carrier, and a higher another information ride into a high frequency carrier. But both of these three are fed directly to the transmission line, like a coaxial cable. So is there interference that will happen among them? So the answer is wala, because they have different carriers. No? So dun pa lang sa idea na yun, masasabi natin na the broadband transmission opens a very great opportunity for the technique known as tinatawag nating multiplexing. So the advantage of broadband transmission is that unang-una, we can definitely use the free space medium as our medium. Available siya for broadband transmission. Pinaka convenient niya is the wireless system nga, no? So hindi ka na connected directly or hindi ka na necessarily na attach sa isang transmitter para ma-receive mo siya, no? That's mobility and convenience. Accessible yung ating free space medium for that. Ang pangalawa, yung tinatawag natin na multiplexing. Ito, in data communication, it can allow a coaxial cable to carry RF signals across multiple channels. So that is what we term as multiplexing. So advantage of broadband is we can utilize the free space channel. We can always make sure na yung ating mga signals are everywhere and kayang ma-access ng kahit sino man as long as within the coverage. It's wireless, kumbaga. And pangatlo is that techniques in digital comms is posibleng magamit using broadband transmission such as multiplexing. So there are a lot of advantages using broadband transmission. But again, hindi pa rin masasabi natin na wala nang gamit yung baseband. No? So depende pa rin sa application in the end. So if the application is short distance lang, you want a faster, less noise, then much better talaga na gumamit ng baseband. So depende talaga sa kung ano yung application. So ano yung advantage of baseband, paano mo utilize yun, ano yung advantage of broadband, paano mo utilize yun. So that all depends sa application na kung saan sila gagamitin. Okay, so now let's move on to electromagnetic spectrum.